Half-a-day students, I am Governor Lou Leon Guerrero. You all have been through a year of big changes. We've had to adapt and make big changes to keep our families and our island safe. But with change comes opportunity and a chance to try new things like PBS University. While Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio and I will continue to do our part to keep our island safe, you students have a part to play as well. Your part is to keep learning and to keep up with your lessons. That's why I am happy to see you here ready to learn with PBS University. PBS University is a way to bring a continuous educational curriculum to you while you stay safe at home during this time. To help you keep up with your studies, we asked our friends at PBS Guam and the Guam Department of Education to put together this episode. Thank you for doing your part and have a great lesson.
PBS University is a program by PBS Guam and the Guam Department of Education in conjunction with public school teachers. These lessons are created to provide both parents and students with a unique educational experience while helping students to continue learning at home. PBS University, next on PBS Guam.
1, 2, 3, 4!
Come along, let's sing a song, we'll have a great adventure.
Today's the day, let's learn and play,
we'll have a great adventure.
Numbers,
letters,
science, things,
all that we can do. Help you deal with how you feel, share with us too.
It's super cool and just like school,
our awesome learning adventures. So grab a friend, the fun will end, our awesome learning adventures. Awesome learning adventures with PBS University.
Half a day, everyone, and running in. Thanks for cruising on by to see me, Miss Cruz, for your 3rd through 5th grade literacy lesson. I hope you're all excited because today we're going to be learning all about. I hope you're excited because today I get to teach you everything I know about. Hi, yes, I'm trying to tell everyone what we're gonna learn today, and you're being a little bit loud. Is everything okay?
Ugh, sorry, ma'am. We're just having a little disagreement over here.
Nah, a little disagreement? You said I was completely wrong.
Because you are wrong. Everyone knows turtles are the best animals in the world.
Nuh-uh. Sharks. Sharks are the best. You don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, I see. These guys don't know the difference between fact and opinion.
Fact or opinion?
Yep. Looks like you two need to go to fact and opinion court. Half a day, everyone. I'm Judge Cruz, and welcome to Fact and Opinion Court. Today, we're here with Kiko and Issa because they're having a disagreement. Issa, why don't you tell us your side first?
Well, I was talking to Kiko about animals, and I told him that turtles are the best animals. Then he said sharks were the best animals. And I was just trying to correct him, because, you know, he's obviously wrong.
I object. I am not wrong. Sharks are the best animals. Who would ever think turtles are better?
All right, calm down now. So I see the problem here is that you two are mixing up facts and opinions. You see, a fact is a statement that is true. It can be proven to be correct, and it doesn't really change. Let's think of some facts about sharks and turtles. Sharks have gills. This is true. All sharks have gills. That won't change. Sharks can't get rid of them. So that means sharks have gills is a fact. Another fact about sharks is that they have fins. They have several types of fins. They have a fin up top. They have fins on the sides. They have a fin in the back. They got fins all over the place. That's another fact. That won't change. All sharks have multiple fins. A fact about turtles is that they lay their eggs in the sand. We know this is true because so many people have seen turtles crawl across the beach, dig a hole, and lay their eggs in the sand. That's true, so it's a fact. These things don't change, which means that they're always going to be facts.
What's an opinion?
Well, an opinion is something you think or feel. It's not necessarily true, and people's opinions can always change. Saying, "I think dolphins are scary," would be an opinion because it's not really true. It's just something I personally think.
And you could always change your mind.
That's right. What if I said, "I think seaweed feels weird when I step on it"? Is that a fact or an opinion? Kiko, do you agree with everyone?
Oh, that's an opinion for sure, because it's something you think. There's no way to prove that stepping on seaweed feels weird.
Yeah, and you could change your mind about it. Today, you think stepping on seaweed feels weird, but tomorrow, you might think it feels kind of nice.
You guys are absolutely right. Now, what if I said, "Coral reefs help protect our island"? Is this a fact or an opinion? That's right. It's a fact because it's true and it can be proven to be correct.
Oh yeah, our coral reef does help protect our island from being damaged by big waves. That is a fact.
See, you guys are getting the hang of it. Now, let's talk about what you two were arguing about earlier. Kiko, you said that sharks are the best animal in the world. And Issa, you said that turtles are the best animals in the world. Everyone, are these facts or opinions? That's right. What Issa and Kiko said were each their opinions. They had difference in opinions on which animal is the best animal in the whole wide world.
Oh, I understand. What we said is an opinion because there's no way to prove it to be true.
And it's what we personally think or feel.
Yep, but that's okay because everyone's allowed to have their own opinions. Just because we have different opinions doesn't mean that we can't still be friends. I'm really glad you all learned from this experience. However, you're not getting off that easy.
What? Are you joking?
No!
You two are sentenced to community service. You must teach everyone the difference between facts and opinions for the next year. Wow! Wasn't that eventful and dramatic? In my opinion, I think it was a good thing that Issa and Kiko went to fact and opinion court today because they learned so much. In fact, you guys learned a lot just by helping them. You guys are such good helpers. Make sure you remember the difference between facts and opinions so that you don't end up in fact and opinion court today like these guys. Well, that's all the time we have for today. cruise on by next time to see me, Miss Cruz, for your 3rd through 5th grade literacy lesson. Adios!
Hola! Hey guys, that's hello in Spanish. Miss Torres here, your 3rd, 4th, and 5th grade math teacher with PBS University. How are you today? I hope you were able to join me last week when we learned some great card games to practice multiplication facts, because guess what? This week, we're gonna continue, but I've got some dice. Got some green ones, got some red ones. I even have some black ones, and I even have ones that look like candy. Right? Don't they look like candy? So, what do you think I've got in store for you? Well, we've got Miss Selena and Rachel back to show you some fun ways using dice to play games to, of course, what? That's right, practice your multiplication facts. So let's jump right in and have some fun.
Six times three is 18.
Six times one is six.
One times two is two.
Three times two is six.
Four times two is eight.
2 times 1 is 2.
3 times 4 is 12.
5 times 3 is 15.
1 times 6 is 6.
3 times 1 is 3.
6 times 1 is 6.
2 times 2 is 4.
But it's a double, right? So.
So.
No, or do you put the 4 and then cross it out.
Okay.
4 times 4 is 16, but I have to cross it out.
4 times 5 is 20.
1 times 4 is 4.
6 times 5 is 30.
1 times 3 is 3.
6 times 2 is 12.
4 times 1 is 4.
2 times 2 is 4, but then I cross it out again,
yes.
Right?
And then we add all of it together. What'd you get?
88.
I got 63. You win this time.
Cool.
I got 10.
I got 8.
So then I would add mine for 18. And you put 8, right? Okay.
2 times. That's 2.
I got 12. So 14.
Then I put 2.
Yes. So I got 20.
20, 22.
I got 2.
Oh my gosh.
Oh, that was a five. Okay. It was there.
You
okay.
Moved it. Hello.
Okay, so 25.
I got two.
So 37.
What the heck? I got four. It's okay.
I got 18. So 24. Oh no. Okay.
At least I'm going up.
Okay, so 24 for me and
3 for me.
So 27. Okay. Oh, you won this time.
So that's 5.
So you got 15.
Cool.
So I had 5. Oh, you got a good one. Okay, five.
Six,
I got
four,
3.
24?
Yes, and then she got 3, so 27. Then I put 3.
That's 8.
20. 20. So I put 28. 18.
Snake eyes.
Then we add.
Then we add it together, right?
Yeah. Okay. Okay. What did you get?
I got 72.
No one hates
that. I think you won.
Oh yay!
Good job. Good job.
Wow, that was really close. But you know what? Miss Selena and Rachel were sure having a lot of fun. And imagine using a set of dice to be able to practice your multiplication facts and with a good friend and helping each other. I mean, what better way, right? So all you have to do, check around your house, and I bet you can find some dice in an old board game. And if you want, you can make something like Miss Torres made. I've got my board here, just a wooden board, an old board, and I put some felt in it just so you know what? It takes away the noise a little bit of when you drop the dice in it. And some paper and pencil, and that's all you need to have some fun with some friends using dice and practicing your multiplication facts. And guess what? I would challenge your mom or your dad. I bet you could win, right? I think so. So don't forget to join me next week, because I've got one more cycle to go with these multiplication games, and you don't want to miss out. So until next time, bye!
Bonjour, boys and girls. Thank you for coming back and joining me, Mrs. Christine Palma, at PBS University. Bonjour means hello in Haitian Creole in Haiti. Today, we're going to talk about... What are you doing here, Lizzie?
You forgot your paper, Mommy.
But it's just a bunch of zigzag lines. What is it?
A seismograph, duh.
Seismograph. Today, we're going to find out how we measure earthquakes. As you know, I will be your third, fourth, and fifth grade science teacher. In our last episode, we talked about what causes an earthquake. Remember, an earthquake happens deep inside the earth along the boundary of the earth's plates. Plates are large pieces of the earth's crust, and where one plate meets another, they can move in all sorts of directions. Let's review. A transform plate boundary are plates that move side by side against each other in opposite directions. A convergent plate boundary are plates that collide or crash into each other. It can form mountains, and sometimes it can form trenches by one plate going under. And a divergent plate boundary are plates that are actually moving apart. When the Earth's crust breaks from an actual earthquake, that area is called a fault. Here is the San Andreas Fault in California. This fault was formed by a transform plate boundary, so we call it a transform fault. By looking at the picture, this type of earthquake looks very powerful. The Earth has experienced several powerful earthquakes, and we can only prepare for the next big one. These powerful earthquakes have caused buildings to crumble to the ground and even split the land. Little Lizzie is going to show you how earthquakes can cause a lot of damage.
Hi, everybody. My name is Elizabeth, and I'm going to show you what happens during the earthquake. You're going to need two plates and put them side to side together. Then we're going to pour some sand. And now we're going to add animals, buildings, and trees. First, let's start with the animals. Almost done. Let's see what happens when there's an earthquake. Did you see what happened? The trees, animals, and buildings all fell down. This is what happens during a transform plate boundary earthquake. Thank you for joining me. Bye.
Thank you, Lizzie. That is one example of how earthquakes can cause a lot of damage. But the amount of damage also depends on how strong the earthquake is. So, the million-dollar question is, how do we measure earthquakes? There are many scientists who study earthquakes with a measuring tool called a seismometer. A seismometer or seismograph is an instrument that responds to ground noises and shaking caused by earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, and explosions. Some of the movements we can't feel, but there are others that are so strong that it can knock us off our feet. When an earthquake happens, the seismometer will start drawing these zigzag lines on a really long piece of paper. The zigzag lines can tell us how strong and how long the earthquake is. But then, in 1935, a scientist named Charles Richter invented a system of measuring earthquakes. We now call this the Richter scale. Using the Richter scale, an earthquake is given a number between 1 and 10 to describe its magnitude. On a Richter scale, 1 is the weakest and 10 is the strongest. You can't feel a 1, but a 2 or 3 is like your picture frames are swaying. A 3 or 4 feels like a passing truck. A 5 can cause your furniture to move. A 6 to 8 can cause severe damages to buildings and underground pipes. And anything higher than a 9 is near total destruction. The strongest earthquake ever recorded using a Richter scale was a 9.5 magnitude earthquake. It was an earthquake that happened in 1960 in Chile. Another big earthquake happened in Haiti in 2010. There was a 7.0 magnitude earthquake. It was so powerful and caused a lot of damage and hurt a lot of people. I have an idea. Let's build our own seismometer to detect any ground movement. You're gonna need a scissor, tape, marker, some coins, a bunch of paper, string, a cardboard box, and a plastic cup. Where's my plastic cup? And one other person to help you. Lizzie! Hello everybody, we just finished making our seismometer. Let's see if it works. Hold this paper and it's not shaking. Oops. It's shaking, it's shaking. Make it stronger. Ooh, not too strong. Now stronger, now stronger. Strong earthquake. Whoa! Let's take a look at our seismograph. This is where we started. And as you can see, the line demonstrates that it wasn't shaking. And as soon as Lizzie started shaking the box, it started making really, really crazy zigzag lines. And as it got stronger, the markings got a little bit crazier. What is this called, Lizzie?
A seismograph.
That's right. It's a seismograph. Good job. That was such a fun experiment. I think I'm gonna keep it in my room just in case there's an earthquake I can't feel in my sleep. I hope you enjoyed making a seismometer with me, and if not, I hope you enjoyed the experiment. Perhaps one day you can be a scientist who studies earthquakes. In our next episode, we will be talking about how we can best prepare for the next big earthquake. Until then, please remember that you are so smart, so awesome, and so special. Stay safe, everybody. Goodbye.
Hafide students, welcome to PBS University. My name is John Fernandez, and I'm the superintendent of the Guam Department of Education. These PBS University lessons are made to help you to continue learning. The teachers here prepared fun lessons on science, character education, math, English, and more, and they made it for you, the students of Guam. We're very grateful to them for their instruction. We're also thankful for you students, parents, and guardians who are watching. Remember, stay safe and healthy, and we'll see you soon in the next school year. Thank you.
Buenas, and welcome to Legend Has It, the show where you hear it straight from the legends themselves. And here's your host, Ton Ricardo.
Hafa day, and privyet, everyone. So, I ran into a friend of mine who's from Russia. Don't worry, we're okay. You know, ran into each other. Okay, sorry. Anyways, he taught me the Russian word for hello. And I'd like for you all to say it with me. Are you ready? Privyet! All right, it's good to see you all. You know, I almost didn't make it. There was a long line to gas my carabao. Hey, just kidding. I rode my moped today. So, did you guys catch last week's show with our guest, the Duendes? Well, don't worry if you missed it. It was a little short. Hey, well, come on. It's just a joke. Well, if this is your first time checking us out, then thanks for tuning in. Here at Legend Has It, we learn about legends. Legends are stories that tell us about a place's history, or they teach us lessons about being good people. But we don't tell the stories. You hear them straight from the legends themselves. And we've got a great show for you today. Please welcome to the show, all the way from Longfit River, see Sirena. Hafa day, Sirena. You know, we've been trying to get you on the show for a while, and I'm glad we finally caught you. I mean, got you to join us. Well, thanks for inviting me. I've been trying so hard to get here, but... well, so, legend has it that you weren't always a mermaid. And, well, first of all, I gotta say, your tail is fabulous. Where'd you get it? Let me tell you where I got it, or who I got it from. So, my mom, she gave me a bunch of things to do, like a whole lot of chores, like sweeping and doing the clothes, like washing the clothes, and I have to hang them out to dry, and then sometimes I have to kunzu the coconut for the kelaguin. It's just basic stuff. But I just love to swim, so I'll do a little bit of work and then sneak down to the river for a swim. Sirena, do you have to do all of those things every day? No, but... so, what happened? Well, okay, I did sweep, but I couldn't find the coconut. So I went down to the tree that's by the river, and I couldn't help it. the water was so nice that day and it was so hot. So I thought, just a quick little swim. But before I knew it, the sun was coming down and then I heard my mom calling.
Oh man, when you saw her, was she wearing only one zori and holding the other one in her hand?
No, but she was a little mad. She told me that I could swim all I want, but I have to finish my chores first.
Okay, but I still don't get, where did the tail come from?
Right. So the next day, I did the laundry and I swept the floor again. Then I remembered I didn't get the coconut. So I went back to the river and I went for a swim again.
Okay, let me guess. The sun started to come down and then your mom was looking for you?
Yeah, she was more mad this time. And even though I did more work that day, she told me that if all I wanted to do was swim, well, the next time she finds out that I did go swimming, she's gonna turn me into a fish.
Oi.
I knew she was really mad, so I made sure to do my work, but...
But?
Okay, so 2 days later, she asked me to go to my Nina's house, and she wanted me to pick up the kudu that my Nina made. Well, my Nina's house, it's on the way to the river, and well, I jumped in for a real quick swim, but I didn't know that my mom, she was following me, and oh, she got so mad, and she said, I've got enough, or I've had enough with you, Sirena, and she turned me into a fish.
Like a whoa.
And so I was crying to my mom, please, please, please change me back. And I guess my Nina heard us arguing, so she ran down to the river and she saw me. So she asked my mom to change me back.
It doesn't look like she changed you back.
What ended up happening was they said that from the waist up, I would change back to a girl, but from the waist down, I would still be a fish. And so that's how I got my tail.
Wow, that is some story. Is there anything else that you want to share with our audience?
To all the kids out there, I know that sometimes your parents or the people that are taking care of you, sometimes it might seem like they're being so mean because they give you so much to do, but they're not trying to be mean. They want to teach you how to be responsible and to show respect. And they also want you to know that there's a time and place for everything. I mean, remember my mom? She said that I could go swimming anytime I wanted. All I had to do was what she asked me to do first. When you don't obey your parents, well, sometimes there are consequences.
Well, there you have it. Straight from the legend herself. You know, Sirena, it was so nice to finally have you on the show. And sidzuus ma'asi to all of you for joining us. I'm Tunrikadu, inviting you to come back and join us next week with our special guest, the Tau Tau Mona, right here on Legend Has It. Adios.
Take one.
Half a day and konnichiwa. Konnichiwa is a greeting from Japan. Welcome back to PBS University. I'm Mrs. Borja, your third through third grade teacher. Oops.
Cut. Take two.
Half a day and konnichiwa. Konnichiwa is a greeting from Japan. Welcome back to PBS University. I'm Mrs. Borja, your third through fifth grade character education teacher. Today's topic is making mistakes.
Cut. Take three.
Mr. Mistakes.
Cut. Take four.
Today's topic is making mistakes. Whew. Making mistakes is so natural. We all make mistakes and it's okay to. We don't come with remote controls, so we can't rewind and redo things, but there are still ways to deal with and recover from making mistakes. After we make a mistake, some of the different things that we can do are ask for help, take a breath or take a moment, or try a different way. But two of the most important things to remember when we make mistakes are one, that everybody makes mistakes and it's okay, and two, try again. Let's watch how little Madi handles making mistakes.
Take one.
Chocolate bits, my favorite. Cereal, milk. Oh, what am I missing? Cut. This is where it would be nice to have a remote control so we could rewind and undo this mess. But we don't. Let's see what little Madi does after she cleans up this mess.
Take two.
Can someone help me, please? I tried to do it by myself earlier and it was too heavy. And I just made a mess. Thank you. Nice job, little Madi. She tried again. She asked for some help, but she didn't give up and she tried again. Let's see what she does here in her classroom.
Take one.
So this is my project, and I decided to do my project on photosynthesis.
Cut.
Aw, little Madi seems a little nervous. Some people can get a bit nervous when they're talking in front of a whole class. Let's see how she handles this mistake.
Take two.
I mean, this is my project, and I decided to do my project on photosynthesis. Photosynthesis is the process where plants take light and carbon dioxide and water and turn it into food for themselves. It looks like she took a breath and took a moment to get her thoughts and her words together and tried again. And I think she nailed it. You know, it's good that she didn't just get embarrassed about making a mistake and give up, because it looks like she worked really hard on her project. And after trying again, I'm pretty sure that she got a good grade on that one. Well done. And now, school's out, and little Madi is on her way home. So let's check in with her one more time before we go. Looks like little Madi is having a hard time tying her shoelaces. and there isn't anyone around to help her, and she can't just walk around with her shoelaces untied. What is she going to do? That's another thing you can do if you make a mistake with something. Try doing it again a different way. She had a bit of a hard time doing it one way, stopped, and tried it a completely different way. And you know what? She got it no problem. Well, it's almost time for me to say bye for now, but remember these two things. One, everyone makes mistakes, and that's okay. And two, when you do make a mistake, try again. And you know those different ways that little Madi worked through her mistakes? Asking for help, taking a breath, and trying a different way? You can switch them around and use them in different situations.
Take four.
Thanks for hanging out with me today. I'm gonna end with some actual bloopers or mistakes that I made while making this video. But first, I'd like to say join me next time for more fun. And until then, be good, read books. Bye!
Cut! Reset.
I'm ready.
Okay. We're rolling.
And I think she got a pretty good grade. Well done. We're gonna run that back because I went off script and then I didn't know what I was saying. I was born ready. That's it. We're done!
For day, my PBS friends. Runanim. Runanim also means half a day in Chukis. Runanim, my friends. Welcome to Cha 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 Tomorrow Time. Guahusi Sinora Bobby. Today's lesson, we will be learning about Respetu. Respetu is very important to me and my family because it shows that I love and I care for my familia. Do you love and care about for your familia? At the end of this lesson, I want to show you my award for being very, very respectful. All right, are you ready? Are you ready to show what you and how you can be respectful? I am too. Get ready! Respetu or respect. Can you say respetu? Maulik. Respetu is when you show love, like showing love to Nana and Tata, your mother or father. Yes, and even Nanny. That's one of the words that we're learning today, but the next word we're gonna learn is also Gai Respetu. Can you say Gai Respetu? Maulik, that's being respectful. And being respectful is also very important because you're respecting everything around you. The next word is Tai Respetu. Can you say Tai Respetu? Maulikeno, but Tai Respetu means disrespectful. I remember one time when I was going to school, someone was being very Tai Respetu to me by bullying me, and I was so tristy. Oh man, have you ever been Tai Respetu? Or has anybody ever been Tai Respetu to you? Oh no! Let's make sure that that does not happen again. Let's show respetu everywhere we go. Right? Maulik. Great job, my friends. So going back to respetu, respetu plays a very important part, not only in your guma, your home, but in the comunidad, right? The community, and it's most especially in the escuela, in the school. Respetu goes a long way, and that's how I got my award for Respetu. But I'm going to show you as soon as we are done going through everything that we can do to show Respetu and have Guy Respetu. Right? Maule. So, before I continue, I wanted to ask you a question. Have you ever been very, very Guy Respetu in the community, at home, or in the escuela? Oh, awesome! Maulik and all. I'm glad you have. What about Thai Respetu? Have you ever been Thai Respetu? Oh, no! Let's make sure that doesn't happen again by showing love, by showing Respetu to everyone. What do you say, my PBS friends? Awesome! Oh my gosh, I love it so much. Respetu going on right here in PBS. That is so awesome. Maulikena. Well, my friends, I hope that we all can go around and share Respetu to everyone. Don't forget, show us Respetu in your home, your guma, in your comunidad, the community, and in your escuela. What do you think? Yeah, awesome. I think it's awesome too. So one more time, let's see if we can also show Respetu abroad, huh? Right? What do you think? I think it can happen. You and I can show Respetu everywhere we go, because Respetu, or respect, is super, super important. And you know what, my friends? You are just as important. Isn't that great? Awesome! All right. So going back to my award, I got this award because I was being so Respetu. And I made sure every day when I would walk into my escuela, my school, I would see things that I could do while I was helping to be Respetu. Like picking up the trash if I see it on the floor, or helping my teacher in the classroom. How many of you guys like to help your teacher in the classroom? Awesome. Maulik, me too. And I was also very Respetu by being friends with everyone in my school and not being a bully. That's right. I was being very, very Respetu to make sure that I knew what I had to do to be a great student. Because you know what? That's Respetu. And that is just as amazing as getting the award. But now, let me show you, after we do our review, what my award is. Are you ready to see that? Because I know I'm ready to share it with you. So don't forget, be very Respetu and show Guy Respetu when you are in school. Mungatai Respetu. All right, guys. Maulik. All right, my friends. Let's review the words that we just learned about. The three words are Respetu, Guy Respetu, Thai Respetu. All these words are very, very important, but Respetu is our most important one. Now, let me share what my award is. Are you ready? Here we go. I got this for being very respectful. Yeah, here we go. Oops, I better not blow this because Nana is sleeping. All right, my friends, thank you for joining me for Cha-Cha-Cha Chamoru Time. Have a great day. Adios.
Fast, fun facts. Fast, fun facts. With Mr. Ernest Pochoco.
Hi guys, this is Mr. Ernesto Choco, boop, with another fast fun fact. Minga la ba, minga la ba. Say it with me, minga la and ba. That is how you say hello in Burmese. Burmese is one of the languages that they use in Myanmar. Myanmar is a country in Asia. Now, why are we speaking in Burmese today? It is because there is an animal that lives in the Burmese or in the Myanmar forests. It has long teeth and claws. Do you guys know what it is? Well, let me give you another hint. It's got stripes. Do you know what it is now? Yes, correct. It is a tiger. And we've got a question from a viewer from the Philippines, from Cebu. All right, it is from Pipai in Cebu. And she asks, why do tigers have stripes and why do zebras have stripes? Interesting. Let's check Dr. Ernst Einstein because he's our science guy and he's super cool and super smart. Let's go check him out. Wow! Very good question, Pipai. So let me tell you, both animals use stripes for different reasons. The tiger, an apex predator, that means it is on the top of the food chain. It will eat all the other animals underneath it. And that means that no other animals will eat the tiger. Now, the tiger uses its stripes as camouflage. That means it can hide in the jungle. And then when the time is right, it will stealthily creep up on its prey. Stealth meaning it's very sneaky. And it can go to its prey and it will pounce and have its dinner or lunch or breakfast. Now, the zebra uses its stripes for different reasons. The zebra uses the stripes as a way to confuse predators. So imagine all those stripes on the zebra and it is running around with its herd. That means all the other zebras running around. And imagine these are the zebra stripes and they're running and running and running, and you are a predator trying to find out which one to pick, and you cannot pick which one because it keeps changing and confusing you. And that is why the zebra has stripes. Very cool. Wow, I had no idea that that's what the stripes were for. I thought they were just fashion. No, I'm just kidding. Well, they are kind of fashionable for the forest, right? And I had no idea that tigers had stripes also on their skin, not just on their fur. And isn't it cool that zebras can confuse predators with just stripes? So I wonder if that'll work for humans. Like if I were to wear stripes, if I didn't want to see somebody and I wanted to avoid them, and I'd go next to people with stripes and just move really fast. Probably not. But anyway, that is your fast fun fact with me, Mr. Ernest Ochoco, and Dr. Ernst Einstein. We'll see you again. Bye, guys.
Half a Day students, I'm Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio. For more than a year now, you all have continued to wash your hands and watch your distance from others, and you've done a really great job wearing your masks. We know your parents and guardians have helped you to make these changes to keep yourself and your community safe. As Governor Leon Guerrero said, we are happy you are here. We want you to continue to learn and sharpen your skills with the help of PBS University. This program is the result of a collaborative effort. We couldn't do it alone. I'd like to thank the teachers and support staff of the Guam Department of Education and PBS Guam for their work and their commitment to our students. I'd also like to thank you, students, for participating at home. To your parents, I'd like to thank you for taking an active role in your child's education. We are all eager to return to a time when all of us can share and study together in person. Until then, we hope you learned something new from this PBS University instruction.